One of the things I was going to ask that I think is really important is that people talk about that the officers in my community should live in my community, otherwise they won't have a vested interest in that, right? And you were just talking about, Chief Stewart, you were just talking about how to even get applicants to apply, and then those same applicants that apply for you apply across the metro. So the pool is even, is not necessarily a good pool. So first of all, is it important for officers to be able to serve in a quality way, to live in the neighborhood, or live in the service area that they work in? Do they need to live there? I mean, is that a valid principle for law enforcement?
I think that, if you look back historically, and I don't know how far you have to go back, maybe 25 years, cities like Minneapolis and St. Paul had residency requirements. And they were abandoned for a number of reasons. One of the reasons, I think, is that it really matters more what a person does when they're at work. You know, I've got folks that work for me that come in and volunteer their time as a big brother to a kid in one of our schools. In fact, the majority of our cops are big brothers or big sisters. I've got police officers that, donated hundreds of their own dollars for our Shop with a Cop program last year. They come in for different community celebrations. They come in because they want to see the play at the high school and support the people in their high school. But there's also that piece about when you're in law enforcement, you do want to clock out too. You know, you want to go home and you just want to be a resident of the community without everyone in that neighborhood knowing that you're a police officer, or without your school-age children having to be in a situation in school where the other children in the school know that your father's a police officer, and they may have had negative interactions with the police as a result of their own behaviors. And so I think that we've really come to a realization as in a profession that it's much more important as to what you do when you're on the job and your commitment to the community that way than, where you live, geographically.
Yeah. Other folks, what do you think about that?
And I'll echo what the chief said, that, residency is no longer legal in the state of Minnesota with law enforcement, that it was at one time in the city of St. Paul as well. And I think it's a valid concern or a valid want for the community to want their police officers to live in the community. We do have a number of police officers. I don't have a statistic. I wasn't prepared to speak on that as to how many of our officers live in the city, but we do have a great number. I lived in the city both as a child and as an adult in the city of St. Paul on our west side and our east side. But I would echo that. I think you can come into a city in which you serve, and I think that you can do a job that you feel good about and really feel vested and feel committed to solving problems and being a part of that community without actually living there. I see a value in both. I don't think it's impossible to live in a community, or not live in a community rather, and still give 110%. I think that's absolutely possible.
I agree. I think it's more important how you feel about people, right, and their circumstances, and improving the quality however you can in any particular neighborhood than whether you live there or not. I suspect historically that had its place, and administratively, let's face it, the unions did away with that, giving people the choice to live wherever they want. They fought that battle and they won it. And so it's our job now, right, to manage around that, quite frankly. I agree with what's been said. I'm more interested in what that officer is doing when he or she is working there. I'm more interested in whether or not they volunteer. I don't care what their zip code is. I don't hire people to work for the St. Cloud Police Department if they haven't volunteered. It's one of the, once they make it through our process, the last stop is me, and I have three simple questions for them, and that's the most important one. Because if you have never done anything for someone else, right, without expecting something in return, I don't think you'll be as effective at this job as we need for people to be right now. And That also answers one of the other questions that you were talking about, which is how to stave off the cynicism. Right?
Yeah.
That has worked well for me in my 20-plus years, is to just disconnect and just go and volunteer as Blair, mm-hmm. right? Not as a chief, not as a peace officer, but as a human being, to just go and be of service to others in a different way. And I encourage my staff to do that. I certainly can't make them, but I strongly invite them to do that, because it works, right? Along with a whole bunch of other things, right? We've got crappy diets, we don't exercise enough. So whatever we can do, some of us anyway, whatever we can do to help eliminate and alleviate some of those pressures,
Before we go into to that line of questioning, I do want to back up a little bit, because you said something that was a drive-by, and I want to pause a little bit and have some conversations about that, if you're able to do so, which is, you said that unions really have impacted how you're able to do your job in terms of the unions did away with certain kinds of procedures that you alluded to. Mm-hmm. Are there other ways in which unions have made it difficult? And I'm not sure even if difficult is the right word. Here's an example. There's a high profile case that's in the metro where an officer was involved in a shooting, was relieved of duty, given a leave of absence, I do believe, and was brought back to work, and so people were outraged about that, and not everyone understands the nuance of that thing. Are there oftentimes decisions that get made that may be out of, from an administrative point of view, out of your hands, given how unions operate or the roles unions play?
Let me take that real quick, and then I'll step aside here, but because I want to be clear, I'm not anti-union.
I'm not suggesting that.
No, I know that, but for our viewers,
yeah.
I want to make that clear. In fact, I was a union steward when I was a deputy in Dakota County. I was born and raised in the cradle of the American Labor Union. I'm born and raised in Detroit, so I get it, and they have their places. The answer to your question is, yes, sometimes it can be challenging, right? However, the same principles we've been talking about here that work and help us engage in our communities help us work with our collective bargaining unions, right? And that is building relationships, having a place at the table for them where everybody's voice can be heard, but making it clear that at the end of the day, right, the business of running the agency every day begins and ends with us. And one of the things I like to tell them to drive home my point is, when something goes sideways, I'm the one that's going to be in front of the microphone bank, not you guys. So some of these decisions rest with me. That's why we're where we are. But certainly, when it's prudent and we need their input, we're able. I'm sure we all have some variation of a labor relations board within our agencies. And so that helps us smooth out some of those rough edges.
It's about due process. I mean, in many respects, and everybody probably at some point in time around this table has benefited from being a member of a union. At the same time, I think we can find much the same way that for many of us, what happens in the criminal justice system process is a mystery. Because of a range of decisions that have been made over a long period of time, those very same kind of implications exist within the collective bargaining arbitration processes, and those decisions certainly impact the people that sit around this table and the people that, with the exception of the sheriff, that we report to around the fact that there may be limitations based upon prior decisions that set precedent and those sorts of things. All of us, want to have good, fair, sound workplaces, all of us, regardless of whether you're in law enforcement or not. Law enforcement is one of those, I think, strange professions where doing your job can land you in the middle of not just having your job on the line, but potentially looking in prison. And I think that can be a game changer, I think, for many officers. And so while unions can certainly be a frustration for in given instances or circumstances that we may have, they have a historically profound role in our country and certainly in our profession. And I think we need to work through the range of issues as Chief Anderson said, and do that through sound relationships. But there's no doubt that I think when we look at these cases, it can become complicated. It just can, and we just have to face that as a reality.
Thank you. For no, I mean that's a tricky line to walk in, and oftentimes, you know, as a community member, I don't know understand those nuances, and so when I see things happen, I'm shocked.
And like, keep in mind too, Andre, in an agency my size, I don't have one union, I have seven different collective bargaining units, right, to represent the different job classifications and descriptions. So again, it's about building that relationship and working through, you know, whatever challenges. But, you know, there are many challenges, right, for what we do. That's one of a long list that it would take us all year to go through.
Well, do you think it's ever inappropriate for one of those collective bargaining units to speak either on your behalf or outside of having conversations with you all as the kind of the bosses? I mean, you're the chief, you're basically the CEOs of your departments, and you work in that level of administration. Is that ever inappropriate, or how do you nuance those conversations about their protection of the union member versus the image and responsibility that you have to the public that you serve?
I think it's a great question, because I think, you know, there's nobody who hasn't seen cases where union leadership has taken a really kind of strong position about any given issue that exists. And while that we may disagree with that, in some cases we may disagree profoundly, in some cases we may have some agreement. We also live in a country where there is, we protect people's right to speak to those things, and certainly that can be frustrating for the people who are trying to deliver a message and those sorts of things and trying to move in a given direction. But this is, I mean, this is the nature of a democracy in which there is some level of leadership and union leadership is granted a voice. A role, and as a result of that, they have a whole series of protections that are absolutely understandable and yet can be frustrating. I mean, in my own agency, we, you know, faced a lawsuit by our union relative to implementation of certain elements of a body camera policy. You know, it's just a reality of the way things are, and we try to work through those things through sitting at the table. In some cases we can, in some cases we can't. And that's what the systems are set up to address. And at the end of the day, we place trust in the systems who get to make those decisions, and we move forward. And there are times when those decisions may be to the benefit of us as the decider, the executive, chief executive, as you call it, or in some cases it may go the other direction. And that is, in fact, I think one of the beauties, the messy beauties of a democratic society who places significant trust in laws and rules and systems of governance.
I think another thing, and I don't want to reiterate what's been said here, because they've been very eloquent in talking about the relationships with unions. It's a really difficult job to be a law enforcement officer, and so you have to be afforded certain protections. One of the things that I think that is confusing to people is binding arbitration, and that's something that you see in Minnesota. You see in a number of states, where other states, I think, are probably more of a right-to-work state, where the chief executive, the chief of police, the sheriff, or others can make those employment decisions, and as long as they're legal from an ethical standpoint, they're probably going to be sound. Where here, certain times, it's not necessarily the union that's making that decision, but the city or the county or the state, whoever the law enforcement agency would be, makes an employment decision. If the union feels as though it's not consistent with a precedent, past practice, or the bargaining agreement, it's typically then submitted to a person who is supposed to be an impartial arbitrator, who is essentially like an administrative law judge, who hears both sides of the case, the one from the union or the employee side, and then the one from the city side, and independently looks at all of those facts to see if, in fact, what was alleged to have happened, and whether or not the consequence for that action was too severe or if it was appropriate. And so there's certainly, I think, a lot of cases where the chief executive or the community thought that the punishment was just, only to have it overturned by an arbitrator because of any number of factors. And in that particular case, it's not necessarily the union that's overturning it. It's essentially this arbitrator or administrative or employment law judge that's saying that for whatever reason, the penalty was either not just or too severe.
Doesn't make me feel any better.
I understand.
I hear you and I understand it, and but I'm just not.
Welcome to our world.
Right. It certainly makes sense. As we were ending the last hour, I started to introduce, and I do want to come back to this question about where do we find qualified and quality candidates, right? So I want to come back to that after this particular question, which is, where we left off at the top of the hour, this idea of implicit bias. Is it a real thing, or is this more of that, kind of rhetoric and propaganda to excuse behavior that people haven't checked? So can you talk about this idea of implicit bias? Is it a real thing? And then how do you interact with it, dismantle it, deal with it in your municipalities and in your departments?
Well, I think it's a real thing. Absolutely it is. And I think we all have, in my opinion, implicit bias. Implicit bias can be dangerous because sometimes you're not aware of it. I would almost rather have and deal with overt bias because it's a lot easier to see, it's a lot easier to label, it's a lot easier to call out. Implicit bias for me is that, those moments in life where you're a young child and perhaps your mother has you and your brother's hands in the elevator, and that individual, whoever that individual, walks into that elevator, and maybe your parent doesn't even acknowledge their implicit bias. But as that person walks in, they squeeze your hand just a little tighter and they lean back just a little bit that no one in the elevator even notices, but a register happens and something clicks. And over time, those things add up and they mean something. And certainly for a law enforcement officer, the danger in that is that we act a certain way when presented with a certain situation without even knowing that we're acting in that certain way. The St. Paul Police Department last year had a very robust training for all of our employees, both sworn and non-sworn, around implicit bias. We're going to continue that dialogue and that training into 2017, 2018. I mean, these are very important topics for us. But you know how we deal with them? We deal with them head on. And we acknowledge that we have them, that we own them, and then we talk about ways of being aware of them and trying to mitigate them the best we can.
And I think to add to that, Paul did a great job of describing it, but I think the beauty, and I think what's striking about this is that where this whole conversation started and the first segment was really around what are we doing, and we know that if you look at the research, that the more experience we have as people across difference, the depth of our relationships across difference, that implicit bias is reduced. And I think that's the good news. So why is it that we are so committed to trying to build stronger and deeper relationships across the totality of our communities? Because we believe, at least I believe, that that's in part one of the ways which we reduce the all that can come from these implicit biases that all human beings have. And so to me, Building relationships is the answer. And I don't care whether you're in law enforcement or medicine or practicing law. These are the ways in which we do it. We need to strengthen relationships because it will, in fact, help us reduce it along with this, as Paul described, the sense of awareness.
Andre, again, really well spoken by some of the people at the table here. Everyone has that bias. Everyone has the ability to stereotype. And I'm going to jump on what Chief Schnell talked about here, where the relationship becomes absolutely key. In our strategic plan for 2017, every sworn officer has to have at least 20 hours of interacting with the community in a positive community building type of forum. So whether that's working with kids at the school this week, we've got a Pizza with a Cop program. They can go, build relationships that way, whether they're working in one of our multicultural neighborhoods or maybe with one of our Hispanic congregations. I think that, you know, you talk about cynicism. Cynicism can build up through repeated negative contacts over and over and over again, where you don't have some sort of a counterbalance to that, where they're having great interactions with kids, and they're seeing that, gosh, these are really great kids, but, you know, I've been on nights for 3 years, so all the time that I'm going to these homes, you know, there's a domestic assault, or, you know, I'm talking to some kid about curfew, or, you know, there's all of these negative interactions. And so I think that the relationship building that we're talking about is equally important to both the community side, all the different people in our communities that we're dealing with, and for our officers to see that some of these biases are not, in fact, founded in any sort of fact. It's really just a bias that they picked up, you know, maybe from their childhood or maybe from different experiences that they've had in the community or college or wherever they got them from. And so the training, the robust training that St. Paul's had, I don't know of any department that isn't tackling these challenges head on. We understand that there's issues there, and it's a human issue. It affects our profession, but it affects our communities as well. And so the way to get past that really is through building those relationships, getting past some of that negative stereotyping, and learning more about each other. In fact, in some of our neighborhoods, particularly in a multicultural community like Columbia Heights, when we go to neighbor National Night Out, we could have a Hispanic neighbor living next to a Somali neighbor, living next to a Hmong neighbor, living next to a Caucasian couple that's been there for 50 years. So I think that communities work really well when we're helping everyone to develop better understanding about, you know, what some of that looks like, and to understand that, you know, 90% of the things that we all hold dear, like great education and safety and a sense of community, those things transcend cultures, and really, again, there's just a lot of opportunities for us to continue to build that relationship.
How many of you in your departments are running kind of implicit bias trainings or opportunities?
Sure.
Or all of you?
I sent
required for all staff.
What we did in St. Cloud, I sent four of my supervisors, some of whom now are administrators, to a train-the-trainer session. Because I wanted us to be able have a little more control over that training in terms of how often and not be at the mercy of an outside trainer. No offense to them, but I had a different plan in my mind. And our agency it's the right size for us to be able to do that efficiently. So I sent four of my staff out to Connecticut for a two-week train-the-trainer session, and so they come back and they administer the training, and we can share that with the entire region. St. Cloud is the largest city in central Minnesota, and so some of our partners and our neighbors are a little bit smaller, and so if we can put that on, it's more efficient on a regional basis, and we're able to reach out, right, and touch more people with that. And so it's part of our policy now that we do that biannually during our in-service, and it's worked out very well. And one of the more salient points that we like to make with ours is simply this. As you said, Chief, they're there for any of us, for all of us. We're all products of our environment. Excuse me. As long as they don't drive your decision-making when you're interacting with another human being, you're going to be okay. 10 times out of 10. So we stress that point, we drive that point home, right? If they take nothing else from it, those two things, they exist in everybody, but don't let it drive your decision-making and how you treat or interact with another human being.
So, you know, I'm a bit cynical, right? So how do you know that stuff works? I mean, you know, this sounds like some, like, you know, kind of hippie kind of stuff, which is, I'm actually quite surprised to hear officers of the law who are, you know, supposed to be these rugged individualists really talking about relationships. So how do we know that this stuff is working to counteract this thing that, you know, we all say that we all have? How do we know that that's...
When you're not on CNN, when your city's burning down because something awful happened, that's one way, right? When you get calls from somebody that one of your officers has arrested and jailed, and they're calling to tell you how much they appreciate how humane they were treated, right? This stuff is rudimentary, at least the way I was raised, but some people weren't raised well, and so we shouldn't have to go through this, right, as human beings, right? We should just treat each other with the respect that a human being deserves. But those are some of the ways that I know, right, when my citizens call and say, hey, thank you, Officer so-and-so, you know, came to the house. And some of them, like a lot of people, after they have had time to reflect, will even say, you know, I gave that officer every reason to act other than the way he or she did, and they still showed me respect. Those things fill my heart, and we know it's worthwhile when those things happen.
I would agree with the chief, and I think a lot of it comes down to observation. I mean, we look back, we provide the training, we try to hire good people, we train good people, and then we lay out clear expectations. The policies are set in place to enforce what we've laid out as those clear expectations. But then we look at what is our work product. You know, our office hasn't had an excessive use of force complaint in 6 years. That's a positive, I think is a real positive.
That's an indicator.
That's an indicator, right? And so as that's an observation, and it's a measurable observation. And tying into also what Chief Anderson mentioned earlier, the expectation of being engaged in the community. A big part of who we are, and I think it's becoming more commonplace across the law enforcement culture, is whether it's a specialty unit within our office, i.e. dive team, canine, SWAT, or a promotional opportunity, one of those questions is, outside of your current role in the office, what have you done to make a positive impact in the community? Mm-hmm. And when they have that clear expectation, even if it's an ulterior motive, I really want to be a canine handler, so I better go be a scout leader, or I better go be a coach, or I better go do something. Whatever the motivation is, they find that when they get out there, not only does it make a positive difference in the community, but it enriches their own life. And whether they wanted it to happen or not, they start becoming a better-rounded, happier, more productive community member as a result of that expectation. And I think that's a big part of having those well-rounded individuals who don't get as cynical, learn how to manage their bias, and whatever those other challenges they might have had early on, depending on how they were raised, suddenly being a better member of the community makes them a better person all around. And even if it was not the right motivation initially, sometimes having us forced down a different path opens our eyes and do a lot of good things.
That's right. I think
it's the addition of a lot of things. I'll just say very briefly, you know, it's not having certain things present, and we touched on this a little bit, but, you know, it's the absence of internal affairs complaints, excessive use of force complaints. It's the absence of lawsuits. It's the absence of officer and citizen injuries in outcomes. And it is the presence of increased accolades, sometimes those citizens that call up or write an email that just says, hey, I just want to let you know I ran into a couple of your cops and had a really good outcome. And those are really meaningful, and we share those with our officers. Yes. I will tell you that in a time when there's a lot more criticism, and some of which we own rightfully, for law enforcement, I can tell you that through my own experience as well, that the accolades are higher than they've been. Sure. And somebody stopping by while you're out to eat or having a cup of coffee and just saying, hey, Chief Schnell, appreciate what you do. Thanks for everything you do out there. Mm-hmm. And so we're reminded that, and for the men and women that wear this uniform, really, this isn't about a job or a career. This was a calling that we responded to, and that's why we're working weekends and holidays and away from the family and dealing with some of the things. And we feel blessed to have been, you know, to respond to that calling.
And those things motivate me. I know, and I'll bet you it's the same. it motivates me to continue to give them my best and give them the folks that I work with and for some tools, right?
Absolutely.
After the Dallas officers were killed, that massacre, we've got a monument in front of our PD in St. Cloud. There were fresh flowers on it every day for a month, just anonymously. That's how you know, right? Right. Happy people are easier to serve, but small gestures like that, people bringing in their kids to roll call just to say hi, and you know, you'll see the biggest, toughest street cop bring in a kid, right? When they're that big, and we look 15 feet tall to them, and you'll there won't be a dry eye in roll call. And so for me. Boy, as an administrator, yep, good. That means this is working, so we're going to build on that, right? We're going to keep going in that direction.
But I think it also is grounded in the science. I mean, because if you look at the research that exists, I don't want to be the geek here, but the reality is, I mean, that there is good data about the fact that if you're purposeful and if you're purposeful and explicit about trying to address and bring this stuff to higher levels of consciousness for all of us. It makes a difference. Again, even outside of law enforcement, everyone, the more we're aware of it, mindful of it, it makes a difference in the way doctors treat people, in the way nurses treat people, cops treat people, ministers treat people. These are the things that I think that the data is telling us. We know that when that happens, there is less use of force.
Yeah.
And if you look at technology, I mean, a lot of times you hear about the number of incidents of a use of force. Well, for police, if you have somebody that the police officer says, you're under arrest, come with me, and the person pulls away and says, no, I'm not, that police officer grabs them by the arm and says, you're under arrest, and then handcuffs them. In some departments, in ours, that is a use of force, right? Mm-hmm. It's not an inappropriate use of force. It is, however, a use of force where, with technology now, we review every use of force that we have. We look at the body cam video, even if it's just a person that's pulling away from an officer, we want to make sure, was this officer, what were their actions legal? Did they reflect best practices? You know, did they attempt to de-escalate a situation? You know, was there a training issue with this particular officer that we can solve? So I think that, you know, certainly you've got the culture of a law enforcement agency. Everyone that I've been exposed to in Minnesota doesn't support abusive citizens or their rights. But like Paul said, you know, now you can look at data, and data certainly tells a story. It doesn't always tell you the entire story, but data with culture and now technology, I think, are giving us some tools that, frankly, we just didn't have even 10 years ago, that we're continuing to leverage to make sure that, you know, we are accountable to our communities.
So you mentioned body cam, so that's come up a few times. Does the public have access or right to see that, or are there entities that review that outside of your departments that review that? How does the body cam work to increase transparency with the community?
I mean, I think the biggest legislature kind of established, and certainly there was a lot of work done, because it's a tough balancing act. We're trying to balance the rights of privacy of people who call on law enforcement for a whole variety of reasons, and at the same time want to make sure that there is transparency and accountability. And what the law basically says is that if you as an individual had a bad experience with a law enforcement officer, that you as a data subject can access that body camera video. Now that presumes that the case is not an active criminal investigation, but if it is, once that case is charged, you'd get that through the disclosure process anyway. But for the most part, and remember that the majority of contacts that law enforcement officers have around the state and really across this country do not end in an arrest. The vast majority of them do not end in an arrest. And so data subjects can walk into agencies and request to see and obtain copies of that video and get that in whole, because they are a data subject.
Where
don't
are?
You, don't you feel smarter whenever Paul's
no,
around?
No, Paul is like he's my data dude. Like, I'm like,
just being is all
right. Here we go.
I mean, on that line of data, I did want to bring attention to a report by the Dolan Consulting Group, and I think we'll make this available on a link. But it's dispelling the myth surrounding police use of force. And it was a report done by Richard Johnson, a PhD, July 2006. And so I haven't read through this, but I do see, as I glance over it right now, I see an acronym or some three letters that now have evoked an opportunity for conversation, which is BLM, Black Lives Matter. I know that there, particularly in St. Paul, there's been a, and I'm not sure how Black Lives Matter leadership has developed or, you know, what relationship it has to this new administration. I know that the previous administration, there was at least opportunities to talk. I would imagine that that is still the case.
Absolutely.
So with all of us, how or what impact has Black Lives Matter had in really thrusting us into having community conversations? And can you talk a little bit about St. Paul? I mean, the rest of you, I'm sure you've had interactions, but I know that St. Paul has really been in conversations with that leadership.
Absolutely. You know, we've worked very hard and very intentionally at our relationship with Black Lives Matter. I, prior to my current assignment, was the district commander in the Western District, which is the district we're in right now. And many of our past demonstrations with Black Lives Matter have been in this district for a number of different reasons. I believe I had and still have, as do many of the members in our department, a very strong and positive relationship because we understand the need for that relationship, but it's very genuine as well. You know, here's I think what all of us have been talking about. When you get to know somebody, it's really hard not to like somebody or to see things about them that you see in yourself. And at the end of the day, we all want the same things. We want equal access to opportunity. We want equal access to the criminal justice system. We want equal access to housing. I mean, these are just basic things that all of us deserve and want, regardless of where we come from or who we are. I've had a wonderful opportunity to develop that relationship because I've been allowed to with Black Lives Matter. I continue to this day to have very positive relationships with the past leader of that organization and chapter here in St. Paul, as well as current membership. We talk still and text very regularly, get out for coffee and lunch. And that's going to continue to be a important relationship to foster. I'll tell you that we have done things you know, kind of outside of the job as well, and exchange very often over the holidays well wishes and communicate. I've had opportunities to meet each other's families on some occasions, so it's not artificial at all. And again, when you really get to know somebody, it's hard not to see that humanity and to see the humanity in somebody. And when we see that, I mean, aren't we closer to where we all want to be? That's what we're trying to get after. It's just dispelling the fear and recognizing humanity. What a great thing. And let me add one last thing.
Yeah, please.
I unfortunately don't have the opportunity at this meeting to talk about a trip that our department, along with a local group of several people of color, made a pilgrimage to Washington, D.C. this past summer. And we visited the National Law Enforcement Museum, as well as the National Museum on African American History and Culture, and we did a joint visit, this cohort of people. But one of the things that President Obama talked about at the beginning of that inauguration, the beginning of that induction of the Smithsonian, was that he believes that there's people and moments that we can support Black Lives Matter and what that stands for, but then also mourn the death of a law enforcement officer, that they coexist. And in fact, one of the members that was on that trip with us, who is the executive director of the Circle of Peace, often on his lapel, on his suit, wears both a St. Paul police pin that is an exact replica of our patch and a Black Lives Matter pin. That those two things can live together at the same time, that they're not in opposition of one another when you really take the time to understand what those two things mean.
And I think Paul raises a good point. I think these are things that I think we in leadership are trying to bring people to understand the really the key nature of what is oftentimes communicated. And it can be, you know, it can be really challenging, I think, for those of us who've been in some of these discussions, because there are times when people don't want to have the discussion with us simply because I'm in uniform or we're in law enforcement. But that's been more rare. I think it becomes, because of our nature and the role we have, I think, around service, I think it demands that we're the ones who we lean in, we reach out, we make those contacts, we demonstrate, invest in the relationships, as Paul described. And at the end of the day, that's how the relationship will both develop and be sustained. And I think it demands groups like BLM, even the NAACP. I think they demand and call on us to take a look at ourselves, to be better, to find ways to deepen our commitment to service. And I think at the end of the day, I honestly believe. I believe that law enforcement is going to step up, and I believe that what's sitting around this table is a demonstration of that, and I think it's reflected in the willingness of leadership, and really more importantly, the cops on a day-to-day basis, and along with a lot of support and encouragement, despite all of the crazy stuff that they deal with, to be reminded about the importance of equity and fairness. The basic human dignity and the reality of humanity that unfortunately we all carry, and I think that's where what I think these groups represent for me. It's the challenge and the call to be the best we can.
Let me add this, and I need to preface it real quick, and I'll be brief. And the reason I'm prefacing it is because I said it. I was on a panel, and there was an individual from Black Lives Matter, and when I said it, I was told that I was marginalizing people simply by making this statement. Here's how this good old-fashioned Midwestern dude from the great state of Michigan was raised. All lives matter. Everybody's. Sadly enough, America is still polarized in many ways, and race is at the top of the list. I think recently we've started to do it to ourselves more often than not, right? Even the way we refer to each other, right? This is me personally, I get taken to task for it. I don't use the phrase African American because I'm not from Africa. I was born right here in the state of Michigan. I understand what it means and why other people use that term, but I don't, because it further polarizes us, in my opinion. Now, having said that, and being a person of color who was born and raised in America, I think I know all too well what it feels like, just like a lot of people who look like me, to be judged by the worst in your element. And so where I get frustrated with whatever group it is, right, and it doesn't just have to be BLM, that's the group you brought up, but that's what's happening now far too much, right, in law enforcement. And when people who have been on the dirty end of that stick start doing it, it gets very frustrating, right? And so it's a very myopic view, in my opinion. We were talking about it during the break. 99.7% or 99.8% of the peace officers out here in this country do the job the right way for the right reasons. So don't paint every cop with that broad brush, because we have some that we take from the human race who smear the badge, who smear the profession, especially if you've been on the business end of that and you know what that feels like. I would think you would be the last person to do that. So,
well, I don't even know what I can add to this discussion, because, you know, we've got some very, very insightful people here. I think that in a democracy, there's periods of readjustment, right? And there's times where in the history of our country, there's been difficult conversations that have had to be had. And I really think that this is one of those times. There's obviously a big focus on how law enforcement treats people in communities of color. But I also think that it's a much bigger issue, particularly in Minnesota, when you see the disparities in income. You see the disparities in educational opportunities. So, you know, we've got issues. The one that we're talking about a lot is police use of force surrounding communities of color, police bias around selective enforcement, prejudicial enforcement, as it involves communities of color. And to Chief Anderson's point, my experience, I'm going on 30 years as a law enforcement officer working in two very multicultural communities, has been that the officers that I've worked with have been fair. They've, you know, obviously they come from the human race, and there's been times where, you know, officers that I've worked with or officers that worked for me did not meet that high bar of what we expect in our communities from law enforcement, and they were subsequently disciplined and fired. But the vast majority, in thousands of contacts that I've witnessed, have really shown me that the law enforcement officers in our communities here in Minnesota, time and time again, step out to assist other people. They understand their role as a servant in the community, as a partner in the community, and they build those relationships. And so, in a lot of places in the country, I get the sense that the cops are pulling back, right? That they feel as though that they're under attack. Mm-hmm. Where in Minnesota, by and large, I think what you're seeing is the exact opposite. You're seeing police departments saying, if we need to have a conversation about this, let's have a conversation about this. And we'll do it in your mosque, or we'll do it in your church. We'll do it in city hall. We'll do it town hall style. We'll do it in a small group. We'll talk with a group, you know, in some sort of a facilitated dialogue. And I really think that that, again, gets to law enforcement in Minnesota, our high standards, our level of education, and our commitment to fairly serve everyone.
I would just add, I think any time, and I'm not going to focus on BLM, I think any group that comes together to call out social concerns and social issues, that's a good thing. If we're willing to positively and constructively come to the table, let's work together. In this case, if we're talking about police use of force, excessive force, violence, have those discussions, build those relationships, build those communities, and we're all going to benefit. At any point any organization becomes divisive, then I think it's the wrong direction to go, because it's counterproductive. And this is where I'll stir the pot a little bit and maybe stand out on my own ledge. But I also think any time we start breaking the law or infringing upon the rights of others, such as shutting down an interstate,
that was going to be my next thing.
I think that's a clear crossing of the line. I'll be the first person to step out and fight for anyone's right for a lawful and peaceful protest, period. I've got their back. But once any group chooses to start, again, violating the rights of others or breaking the law, then it's just another criminal act, and I'll also be the first one to line up our transport vans and start arresting people.
That's
my stance on it. That'll continue to be my stance, because I don't think, because I'm passionate about something, it doesn't give me the right to violate his rights. It doesn't give me the right to impede your ability to get to the airport, to jump on the airplane and go see your kid maybe for the first time in 3 years, or your right to take your child to the hospital. That's just, in my mind's eye, that's clearly wrong, and it's crossed the line.
So that's, we'll leave that right there, because it's clear. The London fog should be dissipated. I'm also curious that other people have narratives about us, right? So we have the largest Somali population. I have folks that are, I don't know why Facebook chose friends as the connection point for folks, but there are lots of folks talking about, you know, Sharia law being established in Minnesota, that the Muslims are taking over, that there's fear that should be had because of what's happening in Minnesota. Can any of you address some of that from your purview? Because we certainly, I've not been affected by Sharia law in any way, shape, or form. But that's certainly other people's stories about us. So what is our relationship with Muslims in Minnesota?
Well, I'll tell you that, you know, I spoke a little earlier about our new community engagement unit and that we're currently in the process of interviewing for some of those positions that we will hire here for community engagement specialists. And certainly one of those positions will be somebody who is reflective of the community, the Somali community or the East African community, the Oromo community, somebody that is able to, again, better reach that community to let us know what some of their concerns, some of their fears, some of their expectations are, but also for us, again, to hopefully deliver some of the messages that maybe culturally we haven't been as successful with. But I can tell you that we currently already have wonderful relationships. We meet on a very regular basis with the elders of those communities. We attend their functions. We've been invited and have great relationships with the mosques and the imams in our community. The elders have told us that, you know, you don't have to talk about radicalism because through those mere relationships, they've stood up at meetings and said, you know, some of the elders, if that were my son or a relative that I found out was engaged in some sort of radicalism, you wouldn't have to ask me or compel me to talk to you. I would talk to you because I care about this country so much and I care about my son so much that I would want to intervene on that. I can tell you that we very regularly, if there's something internationally that happens, that polarizes sometimes fear around the Muslim community, we're very sensitive to that. And with our community engagement specialists are hoping to be better in tune with that. But it's not uncommon for something that happens in France and Europe and somewhere overseas that when we learn about that, the next day and that next week, we're out in our mosques and we're telling our officers, make some extra trips by those areas where we know our Muslim community is at, because we want them to feel good, to know that that in no way reflects who the individuals that we know and that we serve here are. Your community is better, our community is better as a result of your being here, as your culture, your wonderful food, the different things, the economic vitality that you bring to the community. That's how we feel about it. That's how we embrace our community, our Muslim community.
Yeah, I think also when you look at these issues, you know, extremism, whether in any form, whether it's, you know, Christian extremism and some of the attacks that have happened, both historically and not even all that distant past, there's been things. So I think when we look at this, there are those people, and I think in any place we have to work again on those relationships, and I think when we look at this as an issue of faith, one of the key things, the tenets I think in our country is that people have a right to practice their religious beliefs, and we who sit around this table I think have to defend and protect those rights, and certainly as Paul described with the outreach that they've done at the mosque, I can remember times when there were things that were affecting the Jewish communities where we provided extra patrols around synagogues, where there were incidents that happened with certain Christian churches where we felt the need to kind of reach out there, and because I think it's something that in our country is embedded in our country that these rights are something that we hold dear, and I think you know, there's a natural tendency to be afraid of what we don't know. And I think, you know, we're all learning, and as we deepen these connections, I think a lot of that will dissipate. And I just don't believe, based again on the, as Paul described earlier, the more we get to know people on a personal level, the less those things begin to matter. And yet, we can honor people's need or desire or practices in a very kind of reasonable and honorable way.
In Columbia Heights, we have a significant East African community, mostly Somalis in our particular community. And, you know, I've had experience both in Columbia Heights and in Brooklyn Center, where I started as a police officer, with a number of different immigrant groups. And I would say that my experience with the Somali group of immigrants that we're seeing, they're as active and engaged a group of immigrants as I've ever experienced. I mean, they seek multiple opportunities to reach out. There's a strong desire to be a part of the fabric of our community, whether you're talking about volunteerism, whether you're talking about an event where they can come and build relationships. You know, again, it assists us that we've got an Oromo officer and a couple of Somali officers that are helping us to bridge that gap. Last year alone, I went to three, they called them iftar dinners, which is essentially the breaking of the fast dinner during Ramadan. And when they saw people, you know, from different community members coming or the police coming, city officials coming, I can't tell you how engaging and excited they were, because they really just want to be a part of the community. They want to contribute. They want the same great things for their children that we all want. And, you know, we talked earlier this evening about implicit bias. And I think that there are a number of people that see all of these events that are happening in different places around the world that involve extremism. And then they see legitimately that we've had some issues with some of our young immigrant children being radicalized. And I think that there's the tendency to think that, you know, that because we had those issues and there was some young men that were radicalized, one of them from Columbia Heights, that, you know, the problem is larger and more pervasive than it actually is. Again, the experiences we've had with the Somali community have been absolutely fantastic. I've been asked to come and speak to small groups, convention-style talks about how to build that relationship, and they're very engaged and interested in making sure that we understand who they are and that they want to be great and peaceful community members and neighbors. And, you know, I think that, you know, to the extent that we can continue to educate the everyone in our communities about who the different groups are, Somali or Hispanic or these other cultural groups, I think that, again, you know, it's just going to be a better community where people are more respectful, more informed in who their neighbors are. And, you know, it's a really interesting world right now in Minnesota.
Yeah.
With all of these different cultures that are represented here. And my hope is that people will continue to not act off of a bias or act off of some sort of a stereotype, but really get to know their neighbors and who the people are, because those of us around the table have certainly been gifted the opportunity to meet people from these different cultures. And I can tell you that we're all much richer for having known them.
Well, I want to say
it's another layer
yeah.
of fabric on that tapestry that is America, right?
Yeah.
And so, to steal from the late great James Brown, as long as we step off on the good foot, right, from a place of humanity, right, it shouldn't matter.
That's
now,
right.
We know the reality is right. that there are some people who struggle with that, but that's how we wrap our minds around it in St. Cloud. They're human beings first. I don't care what their religion is or any of that from that standpoint in terms of how we're going to interact or how they're going to get treated. And so we try and do as much as we can, because we have to remember we've got a sizable Somali population or East African population in St. Cloud, but we also have international students from over 20 countries from all over the world, and we don't want to alienate any of those folks. And so our efforts are, you know, a more broader based inclusion for all of those folks. We've got more than 20 or 30 countries represented in St. Cloud, so we do cool stuff like Marnita's Table. I don't know if you've ever heard of
that. Yeah, Marnita's Table.
Fantastic.
It's
so
food.
Yeah. it can be done.
But one of the things, I apologize that we've kind of run out of time for this discussion, and I hope that we have other opportunities to have these discussions and that your brothers and sisters in law enforcement will engage in these kinds of forums. So that you're not talked at, but we actually get to hear what's on your hearts and on your minds in terms of the communities that you serve. And so I want to say thank you so much for joining us here with Beyond the Rhetoric 2, Community Policing. And let's take it out with that James Brown. Take it off on the good foot. All right. My name is Andre Koen. Thank you so much for visiting with us and sitting with us in this conversation. Have a good night.